Today I'm talking about the Holbein 1000 palette, the 250, a couple of other palettes, maybe some of these, maybe one of these, maybe this guy? Nah. This is Brian again, and today I'm talking about studio palettes, more specifically the Holbein 1000 and 250 models. But I thought I'd start with this palette. This is the type of palette that I've used for probably a good 25 years or so. This is the type of palette that I started with and used pretty much right up until just a few years ago. This is a plastic palette, kind of a vacuum formed plastic palette that's pretty thin but effective. It has four wells on the lid here. This is actually made by, I'm not sure what the company is, but the name of the palette is the Robert E. Wood palette. And it's a nice palette, but I found that it had some downsides for me. I got to the point where I wanted to kind of hover over my work and hold a palette more often rather than have it off to the side. And so this got to be a little cumbersome. It's got, you know, nice big mixing areas inside. It's got a lot of paint wells for your paint. But it just ended up starting to take a lot of real estate up on my desk. And so I started looking for something that I could maybe use in conjunction with this, and which led me to kind of a cheaper plastic palette like this. I was looking for something that that I could hold kind of over my work, that had a thumb hold that I could, you know, hold it this way and paint. And this worked for a while, but it turned out that it stained very easily. And the paint wells were pretty tiny for some of the larger brushes. So I started looking for something that would combine the best of both of these types of palettes. Something that had a decent amount of mixing space without taking up, you know, a gargantuan amount of real estate on my table. And something that was maybe a little bigger than this, a little more high-end. I mean, and of course, any palette that you choose that will hold your paints and mix paint is great, and anything will work. But I was looking for something that I could bang around a little bit, something that would hold up over time. This always felt a little cheap and stained easily. So what I decided I would go with is the Holbein 1000. This was a gift from my family. But I led them in the right direction on what I would like to have. And they got me this, the Holbein number 1000 palette. And this is a steel palette. There are a lot of aluminum versions of this palette from other companies, but this is kind of the real deal. This is a steel palette, like I said. You might want to take note of this box. That's the official Holbein box. If it doesn't look like this or and doesn't have the Holbein logo, you might be getting a knockoff. So anyway, I love this palette. I love that it folds open and has a decent amount of mixing space. I like its sturdy construction. I like the paint on it. It's got a Japan to finish. Whatever that means, but I think it's just a sturdier black paint. It's not chipping. Of course, I'm getting a little scratching and stuff on it from it being scooted around, but it's got a very nice finish. The white enamel on the inside is very nice as well. The mixing on this has just been buttery smooth. The paint, you know, on some cheaper palettes can kind of dissipate and kind of bead up into little beads of paint. This, in my experience, has stayed in nice mixing puddles. So I really enjoy it. And like I said, one of the things I really wanted in a palette was the ability to have it be able to rest on my art table, but also have the ability to be handheld like this and be able to kind of hover over my work. This palette has 24 wells, you can see along here, and there's some extras here. I don't use these because, well, obviously I haven't filled up the palette yet, but I just don't need them. But it's nice that it has that many wells if somebody needs that much space. Now, I have heard of a downside to this palette in that they can be prone to rusting. I have not had that issue. I live in a very dry climate, but I have talked to other artists who have had problems with rust. And a friend of mine, Jared, who runs the YouTube channel, Jared Loves to Draw. By the way, if you love watercolor, do yourself a favor and check out his channel. It's amazing. He does amazing, gorgeous work. But anyway, in talking to him, he's had problems with these Holbein palettes rusting, and he's had a couple of the smaller size ones, a 250 that I'll show you in a minute, that he had rusting problems with. But for me, in a drier climate, I haven't had any issues, but I guess that's something to be aware of. Now, the palette closes in half like this, but it doesn't have a snap closure, and that's kind of the one downside to me about this palette. It falls open very easily. It doesn't have any kind of a snapping mechanism there, which is kind of odd to me that they wouldn't build that in to the way the metal is formed. But that's easily resolved with you know, some kind of elastic bands. As a quick side note, be a little wary of other companies making palettes that are like the Holbein. This is one that I bought before getting the Holbein. This is an aluminum palette, and it works great. I keep my M. Graham paints in this one, but it is a much cheaper construction. The metal's pretty flimsy. When it's closed, there's a lot of shifting. Actually kind of closed up on me there in a weird way. Yeah, anyway, these are not a bad option, but be aware that they're out there and they're not true Holbeins. Now, Holbein as a company is kind of interesting because it has a very European sounding name, but it's actually a Japanese company that was founded in 1900. And I'm not sure what they were called before they were using the name Holbein, but they took on the name Holbein in 1946. And it's, from what I understand, it's named for German portrait artist Hans Holbein the Younger. And so I just thought that was interesting. I always thought that Holbein was a European company, and it's actually a Japanese company. So what I would say, if you're looking for one of these now, be a little wary of Amazon. I was looking at a listing for what was supposed to be a Holbein 1000 on Amazon. But when I started reading the reviews, a lot of people were disappointed because they were getting some kind of cheaper knockoff version that wasn't actually a Holbein brand. Even though the description said Holbein, which is kind of odd. So anyway, if I were buying one of these today, I would probably go to eBay, and I would look for a true seller that's selling from Japan that has a high feedback rating. And I, you know, I've bought a lot of different things from Japanese sellers over the years, and the distance to the U.S. is quite a bit, but I haven't had any issues at all in receiving the things I've ordered from Japan. So that's just something to consider. But I would say eBay is probably your best bet, and with a reliable seller, is probably a pretty safe bet. I also want to talk about the Holbein 1000's baby brother, the Holbein model number 250. I picked this up in Denver, Colorado last summer when I was traveling through. I ran into it at an art store there and had to pick it up. It's just kind of a fun little like mini version of the 1000, and I thought it would be great to eventually move into this as a travel palette. Anything that I said about the 1000, in terms of durability, in terms of build quality, paint, enamel on the inside, stands for the 250 as well. It's a great little palette that I can't wait to kind of move into. I'll show you it next to the big one here, and you can see it's kind of just sort of like a cute little version of the 1000. And kind of has the same pluses and minuses. This one also, there's no clasp there of any kind, which is a little annoying, but an elastic band would fix that for traveling. I should also note that Holbein also makes other sizes between these two palettes. They have a model 500 that's a little smaller than the 1000. And then they have a one that's smaller still, not quite this small as the 250, but I believe it's like model 300 or 350, something like that. That's a little bigger than this, but not like these bigger palettes. I thought I'd do a quick sum up of the pros and cons of these Holbein palettes. In the pros category, these are very sturdy. The construction and everything on these is very nice. The paint is nice. It's a nice glossy black sturdy paint. Inside we have the white enameled surface that mixes paints very well. I like the portability of these, especially this 250. When it's closed up, it's pretty tiny. It would go in a bag very easily. The 1000, of course, it's a bigger palette, but closed up, that's fairly portable. It's not too big. It has the thumb hole that helps with portability and, you know, using it outdoors for plein air painting. One of the other things I like is that there's quite a bit of mixing space in these, you know, relative to their size. But there's a decent amount of mixing space in these when they're unfolded and opened up. Cons, things that maybe aren't the greatest about these, price. They're kind of expensive for a palette. This one runs about $100 US. I've seen the 250 in the $60 range when I've seen it for sale. Another thing I wish was better on these, but it's not a deal breaker for me, is that these they don't snap shut at all. That's one thing I wish they did. Another downside would be, and again, I haven't had problem with this, but they can be prone to rusting if you're in a very humid area. And lastly, especially if you're in the U.S., the availability of these is a little hard. You kind of have to do a little digging to find them for sale. But I feel it's worth it if you are someone that likes to have a nice palette. I also want to talk quickly about a couple of other things in terms of using the Holbein 1000 in the studio and something I discovered regarding cleaning these enameled surfaces. I watched a YouTube video by Paul Fogarty. There's not a lot of reviews of the Holbein 1000 out there, and that's one of the reasons I thought I'd do this. But one of the things he mentioned is that when filling these wells with your fresh paint, it's best not to try to get the paint into the corners, because what can happen is when the paint starts to dry and constrict, it can pull the enamel off of the corners and out of the corners and off the edges. So it's best initially, you can kind of see that I've done that here, to put your paint kind of right in the middle of the well, and then let the water and your brush and all that kind of work the paint down into the corners at a more gradual pace. And that way it won't all dry at once and pull your enamel off. I haven't experienced any enamel coming off, but I guess that's something to be aware of. I also use this palette. It's got plenty of mixing space, but sometimes I look for a little extra mixing areas if I have too many washes or something going on. And one of the things that I've found, and this is mainly for US viewers, the Target stores has like a whole aisle of these like white ceramic dishes and things. Like I found, like here's this little square one, some little round ones, and I find these are just great for bigger washes and things. You know, if I need to mix up a pure color of like, say, whatever, you know, this is like a Prussian blue or something, just a nice big amount of just pure color that I use as large washes. These are great for that. Sorry. I also found some other palettes in the same aisle. You know, Target has tons of different dishes and bowls, pretty cheaply priced in these white ceramic things. So that's another option, is, you know, just an extra little mixing tray off to the side, so you have some supplement area there. Now, in kind, kind of in that thinking in that direction, Target also in their bathroom aisle has these ceramic trays, and I just love these things. They're white ceramic, just like the dishes I showed you, but they have this like nice rubbery coating applied to them, so they don't slide around on your table. I mean, they're just a really good size. And I mean, you can see this one next to the palette where I had a little bit of extra washes and things going on. But yeah, these are in the bathroom aisle, and they have them in, I think, different colors of coating. I think there's a black and a green, and but these are really nice. I think they're about $8, $8 or $9. Great stuff. One last thing, two fingers, but one last thing is this brush soap. And I'm not trying to hawk this brush soap to anybody, but I've found, you know, some artists don't mind if they have a little staining in their palettes, and some do, and sometimes it's worth, you know, if you get enough stain building up that it may start interfering with judging your color mixes. For those that like to get it back to just clear, bright white with no staining, this stuff does wonders. It's called the Masters Brush Cleaner and Preserver. I see this all over the place. I've seen it at Hobby Lobby. I'm sure online art supply places have it. It's a great brush cleaner, but when other things have not even touched stains, like I've tried Windex and other soaps and things, some people use like a magic eraser, but that's abrasive and eventually could wear down your surface. So I'm a little wary of using a magic eraser. But anyway, this stuff, you know, I take like a paper towel, wet it, rub it into here, rub it on the palette, you know, and then get a pure paper towel with just clean water and wash it out. This stuff pulls the stains off incredibly well. I don't know what's different about it than regular like hand soap, but this does wonders for stains. This is great stuff. So if you're having trouble with stains on your palettes and you're exasperated, you can't figure out how to get them off, try this stuff. It's worked amazingly well for me, and I've even tried it on some plastic palettes with quite a bit of success. I even tried it on the Robert E. Wood palette I showed you, and it pulled off 10-year-old stains without any issues. So yeah, good stuff. Thanks for watching today. I hope this wasn't too boring. I just noticed there hadn't been many reviews of the Holbein palettes up on YouTube and thought I'd do one. There'll be more videos on painting technique and other things in the future. Thanks for watching, and I'll talk to you later. Have a good one.